The next day, the crowd that had stayed on the opposite shore of the lake realized that only one boat had been there, and that Jesus had not entered it with his disciples, but they had gone away alone. Then some boats from Tiberias landed near the place where the people had eaten the bread after the Lord had given thanks. Once the crowd realized that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they got into the boats and went to Capernaum in search of Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the lake, they asked him, "Rabbi, when did you get here?" Jesus answered, "I tell you the truth. You are looking for me, not because you saw miraculous signs, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. On him, God the Father has placed his seal of approval." Then they asked him, "What must we do to do the works God requires?" Jesus answered, "The work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent." So they asked him, "What miraculous sign then will you give that we may see it and believe you? What will you do?" "Our forefathers ate the manna in the desert. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Jesus said to them, "I tell you the truth. It is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." "Sir," they said, "from now on, give us this bread." Then Jesus declared, "I am the bread of life. The one who comes to me will never go hungry, and the one who believes in me will never be thirsty. But as I told you, you have seen me, and still you do not believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all that he has given me, but raise them up at the last day. For my Father's will is that all who look to the Son and believe in him shall have eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day."
Jesus declared, "I am the bread of life. Knowing you, Jesus, there is no greater thing." Let's stand and sing together the song that we sang part of as the offering was going round. It's number 3, "All I Once Held Dear, Built My Life Upon." Let's stand.
All I once held dear, built my life upon. All this world reveals, and was to hold. All I once thought gave, I am now dead lost, spent and worthless now. Come then to live.
Oh, to know the power of your risen life, and to know you in your suffering, to become like you in your death, my Lord, so with you.
In a moment, Anne is going to come and sing to us again. It's been great to have Anne with us this week, and I know lots of you here have really enjoyed what she's done. If you'd like to hear some more, I just want to tell you about two opportunities to do that. For starters, if you want to take Anne's voice home with you, you can buy a CD on the bookstall there. It's $10.99, and it's called How Deep the Father's Love. And Anne's singing there a series of arrangements by a great Keswick figure from the past, Roger Mayo, and he's also accompanying her. So I'm sure that would be a great treat for some of you, $10.99 on the bookstall. But there's another opportunity to hear Anne this week. She'll be giving a concert here in the tent at 4 o'clock on Thursday, and that's free and open for anyone to come. 4 o'clock on Thursday here in the tent. Thanks, Anne.
Well, I hope you'll be able to hear me above the wind, and I hope these screens don't fall on your heads halfway through. We've just had read to us that Jesus declared that he said, I am the bread of life, and he who comes to me will never be hungry, and he who believes in me will never be thirsty. And so I hope you'll understand that I'm going to sing the words of the Lord Jesus and not my own when I sing, I am the bread of life. I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall not hunger. He who believes in me shall not thirst. No one can come to me unless the Father draw him, and I will raise him up, and I will raise him up, and I will raise him up on the last day. I am the resurrection. And you will raise us up. day.
Thank you, Anne. Good evening. We've had Philip Hacking telling us that he did the young people's meetings in the 60s. And we've had Keith telling us he did them in the 80s. Well, I did them in the 90s. I just want to make that absolutely clear. And what a great time they were too. I'd like you to open your Bibles at John chapter 6, if you would. And perhaps you'd welcome Victor, who's signing tonight. I really feel for Victor because if you decide to switch off and have a little doze or something or think about something else, you can do that. But Victor has to listen to everything and translate it. At least I hope that's what he's doing. He could be giving the football results for all we know. But what I want you to do is to thank Victor and the team of signers that we've got here in the conventional signing way. Now, to sign applause, you do that. That's applause, okay? So when I say three, thank you. Thank you. Now, some of you said you'll never catch me with my arms up in a Christian meeting. Number one, you just did. And number two, we've got it on video. Seriously, the signers do a great job. And I know in our own church, we really thank God for the way in which that opens up a whole new realm for people who otherwise would be disadvantaged. And Jesus cares about anyone who's disadvantaged. So this is an important ministry. I want you to picture the scene. It was a Monday morning not very long ago. I'd had a very busy Sunday. I'd preached at three services, and I had to be in London for a meeting early on Monday morning. So I took the night train from the southwest where I live. Why on earth they call it a sleeper, I will never know. You cannot sleep on one of those trains. So I'd rattled through the night, got into Paddington at about 6:30 in the morning, took a silly decision, really, not to have breakfast, but to press on to where I was meant to be and hoped I'd find a cafe open there. And as soon as I got down onto the underground platform, I realised I should have had breakfast because my body and my mind weren't speaking to each other. Do you ever have days like that? They've had an argument. And I got onto the tube eventually, and feeling far from a little ray of sunshine, pulled a book out of my briefcase that I've been reading. And written by a doctor, the particular section I was reading was all about what to expect when middle age arrived. This is no exaggeration. On that Monday morning, feeling close to death, I read these words. As a person starts reaching the milestone of their mid-40s, you need to take time to learn about the biological changes that are taking place within your body so that you will be better able to understand and cope with the inevitable and completely natural elements of the aging process. The minor aches, pains, dental problems, intestinal malfunctions, muscle deterioration, emotional instability, memory lapses, hearing and vision loss, impotence, seizures, growths, prostate problems, greatly reduced limb function, massive coronary failure, death, and of course, painful hemorrhoid swelling that can make up this exciting adventure we call middle age. Friends, I thought that morning, if this is an exciting adventure, I want to die. The author had a good intention. He was trying to tell me about the exciting adventure of middle age, but his words got in the way. By being so comprehensive in his analysis, he frightened me almost to death. And so often we know in life, tragically we know in the Christian life, that the words that we say and the way that we live can actually scramble the message we're called to convey. John had no difficulty about his message. His words didn't get in the way. But as the Holy Spirit led him and inspired him, God directed him to paint for us in his gospel a portrait of our Lord Jesus. If you turn for a moment to John chapter 20, we actually are let into the author's heart, his mind. Because in John chapter 20, in verse 30 and 31, John explains why he wrote his gospel. He's totally upfront. There's no ambiguity about his words. There's no scrambling of the message. That's what he says in verses 30 and 31. Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. John is very clear about his motive. He wants his readers to come to a point of faith in Jesus the Messiah. To use the title of our Keswick this year, John wants them to have a deep impact. He wants them to meet the risen Lord Jesus, the Son of God. That is his motive. And John tells us too about his message. He says in those words, my message is simply this, that Jesus is the Christ. He is the Messiah, the Son of God. No ordinary man is this. But John, having walked and lived and been alongside Jesus in different experiences of life, says, this is my conclusion. And that, he says, is my message. And so understanding John's motive and the heart of his message helps us to delve a little bit deeper into the method that he uses. Because as both Philip and Ajit on Sunday were mentioning as we began to look together at John's gospel, John writes his gospel in a way that is different from the other gospel writers. Matthew, Mark, and Luke, often referred to as the synoptic gospels, from a Greek word meaning seen together, tell the story of Jesus. But John tells the story of Jesus at a different point in the history of the church. By the time John writes his gospel, he is an old man, mature in years. The church has grown and is established. And that means that John is able to write from a different point of view. Give you one example. When it comes to the night on which Jesus was betrayed, John takes us to the upper room. But John omits the reference to the taking of bread and the taking of wine and Jesus giving them the command to remember him in breaking bread and drinking wine. John omits that, not because it didn't happen, far from it. But John reminds those who are reading his gospel of something else that took place in the upper room that they were in danger of forgetting. By that time, the Lord's Supper, the communion, was already practiced within the church. They were being obedient to what Jesus said, but they'd forgotten what else Jesus did. As well as bread and wine, he took a towel and a bowl, and he washed the feet of the disciples. And he said, I'm your Lord, I'm your master, and I've washed your feet. So you should wash one another's feet. Ajit the other evening referred to the signs in John. And he said that John quite deliberately uses that word. There's another unique thing. And he only chooses seven. In fact, that verse in John 20, he says, he acknowledges Jesus did many other miraculous signs. But out of the many other miraculous signs, John chose just seven. And called them signposts because they pointed to who Jesus was, where he came from, and by what authority he did these things. And tonight in our study, we come to something else that was unique in John because he records seven I am sayings of Jesus. And in his gospel, he deliberately places these at strategic points in the story. And tonight, the verse that we're particularly concentrating on, we're going to look at the whole chapter, but the verse in particular comes in chapter 6 and verse 35. Jesus then declared, "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry. He who believes in me will never be thirsty." Then look again in your Bible, verse 48. He repeats it. "I am the bread of life." A lot of ink has been spilt over the years as people have discussed, why did John focus on these seven I am sayings? Many different reasons have been put forward. Four in particular have great weight, I believe. Firstly, it was a direct link with the name of God in the Old Testament. You remember when Moses said, when God called him to lead the people, "Who shall I say sent me?" God reveals himself to Moses with the divine name, "I am that I am," or another way of translating it, "I will be what I will be." Yahweh, Jehovah, the divine name. Jesus directly aligns himself with the name of God. The second reason was it was a critique of Judaism. Judaism hadn't made it. The Jewish faith had not lived up to what God wanted them to be. That's why Jesus, later on in the Gospel of John, says, "I am the true vine." That time, the vine was even used as a symbol on Jewish coinage. It was a symbol of the Jewish nation, the vine of God's planting. But as the prophets often said, you may be the vine of God's planting, but you haven't produced the fruit. And so the I ams of Jesus were seeking to point to the fact that true bread, true light, true water came from him. Third reason is that Jesus, as Lord incarnate, God in flesh, is able to bear the divine name. This is no prophet, no great leader like Moses coming to carry a message. He is the message. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, the life. No one comes to the Father except by me." But the principle, the fourth reason, the principal theological contribution of the I ams of Jesus in God, in John's Gospel, is what we call Christological. It backs up his divine claims. He works, he acts, he speaks in the Father's name. The signs point to the authority that he works under. And the I ams are those divine credentials laid down on the table. You'll know there are some who said, "Well, actually, that isn't what Jesus really claimed about himself. That was the invention of those who came along later, like the Rabbi Paul. Jesus never claimed divinity." You may have even heard that preached from a pulpit. Often when I've been confronted in a university mission or similar circumstances by people who say that, "You know, Jesus just came to preach the fatherhood of God and the brotherhood of man. Any claim to divinity is something the church tacked on later." I turn in my Bible to John chapter 8. Look at it when you get a moment. No need to turn to it now. But in the dialogue that Jesus has with the Jews there, as the temperature mounts with the Jewish leaders, Jesus says to them, "I tell you, before Abraham was, I am." And the very next verse, it says they picked up stones to stone him. There was no ambiguity in what Jesus claimed. And if there was a misunderstanding, then at that point, he could have cleared it up. John writes about the I ams because, like the signs, they point to who Jesus really is. And so with that, by way of background, let's look at chapter 6. The first of the seven I ams. "I am the bread of life," says Jesus. How do we understand it? Well, chapter 6 is a wonderful chapter. It's a very exciting chapter. This all took place in the space of a couple of days. And it's important that we just understand where in the story of those 2 days Jesus' statement comes in. Back at the beginning of chapter 6, from verse 1 to 15... John tells us the story of the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000, as we know it. Actually, that's the wrong way of describing it. If you read, actually, it was 5,000 men That was a very chauvinistic world. Some of you say hasn't changed very much, has it, in 2,000 years? But they didn't bother to count the women and children. 5,000 men. Just look around the tent tonight, about 3,000 people sitting here in this tent. Just imagine the size of the crowd. Certainly double, if not treble, this number. And Jesus, with a little boy's packed lunch, feeds a multitude. And that's a key part of what was going on. We then read in verse 14, after the people saw the miraculous sign that Jesus did, they began to say, surely this is the prophet who is to come into the world. The Jews believed, going back to a scripture in the book of Deuteronomy in chapter 18, that a word that was brought there from Moses would be fulfilled. Moses said, the Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your own brothers. You must listen to him. And so the Jewish expectation through the centuries had been that one day this prophet in the line of Moses, the mold of Moses, would come. And so they asked the question, could this be him? And maybe the connection was, as we see a little bit later, the manna in the wilderness, that mysterious substance that came down and the people gathered it up and ate it as bread in the morning for 40 years. They thought, this is the connection. This is what Moses did. Perhaps this is the prophet who was to come. Then notice in verse 15, Jesus, knowing that they intended to come and make him king by force, withdrew again to a mountain by himself. He spotted what was happening and the danger of the situation. They were going to come and make him king by force. You ever been in a crowd? I've been in many crowds in my time in sporting events or on railway stations. And you'll know in a crowd there's a sort of a herd instinct. And suddenly somebody will spot an opening, a gap, an exit, and they'll plow for it. There's a herd instinct that takes over. And the herd instinct, as the buzz went around the crowd, was, let's get this man. Let's make him king. This is the prophet. And Jesus, spotting the situation, withdraws and goes up the mountain to be alone. Verse 16, his disciples set off across the lake without him. And the crowds perhaps looked for Jesus, couldn't find him, but they saw the disciples getting into the boat and returning. And then the next little part is the incident that occurs as they cross the Sea of Galilee. A storm suddenly blows up, and then Jesus comes to them walking on the water. They're absolutely terrified. And he tells them, don't be afraid, it's me, and they draw him into the boat. And then they arrive on the other side. Now here's the interesting bit. The next morning, the crowd go looking for Jesus. They haven't forgotten what happened. Verse 22, the crowd that had stayed on the opposite shore of the lake, they realized that only one boat had been there, that Jesus hadn't entered it with his disciples, but they'd gone away alone. And then some more boats from Tiberias on the other side of the lake came and joined them. Landed near the place where the people had eaten the bread after the Lord had given thanks. The word had gone round. Yesterday it may have been 9,000. Today, well, the numbers were really up. Others had come and they brought their boats. They looked for Jesus. Verse 24, once they realized that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they got into the boats and went over the lake to Capernaum. And what did they find? Jesus was there. And you don't need to be a rocket scientist to work out, well, something strange has happened here. How did he get from one side of the lake to the other side of the lake without having a boat? And that's the background to a dialogue that opens up between them. Verse 25, the crowd say, how did you get here? Verse 26, Jesus replies, you're looking for me for the wrong reasons. He says, instead of looking at the meaning of the miracle that you saw, what you really see in me is a meal ticket. That's why he speaks to them so strongly. Verse 27, do not work for the food that spoils, but for the food that endures to eternal life. Jesus said, you've missed the point. In John's language, they'd failed to read the sign, and they'd turned up the wrong road. And then maybe trying to be a little bit more spiritual and sort of deny the fact that we're not looking for a free meal, Jesus. The crowd asked the question, well, how can we please God? Verse 28. And Jesus says, believe in the one that he sent. That's how you please God, by putting your faith, your trust in the one that he sent. Verse 30 and 32, the crowd say, well, give us a miracle. Show that you really are genuine. What sign are you going to give? They refer there in verse 31. They say, our forefathers, they ate manna in the desert. Their minds going back to the previous day and the connection that they'd made with the Old Testament promise. Look at what Jesus does in verse 32. He puts them straight. He says, I tell you the truth. It's not Moses who gave you, who has given you the bread from heaven, but it's my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Jesus puts them straight on two counts. Number one, he says, it was God, not Moses, that fed you. In their sort of folk religion, as they look back, Moses had become the superhero, but he was the servant of God. And the second thing Jesus says is, don't you realize that was 1,500 years ago? And the I am God is bang up to date. Today, in front of you, stands the bread from heaven. Don't just look back with nostalgia to the past. God doesn't deal in stale bread, but fresh bread. Verse 34, the crowd's a bit like the woman at the well in chapter 4 say, well, we'd like that, please. We'd very much like that. And that's the claim that Jesus makes there in verse 35. I am the bread of life, he says. He who comes to me will never go hungry. And he who believes in me will never be thirsty. Jesus is speaking about the spiritual dimension, the soul dimension, the heart dimension. Jesus isn't talking about bread on the table that keeps our bodies fueled and going. Jesus is recognizing that these people, that's what they're looking for, the free meal. Don't have to work anymore. Great idea. Don't have to earn our bread by the sweat of our brow. But Jesus is saying, do you not understand? If someone comes and puts their faith and their trust in me, then spiritually their hunger is satisfied because the gift I give is life eternal. Life that starts now, the life of heaven that begins now and goes on forever. The water that I give is living water that you drink now. You will never be thirsty again. Some of the Jews didn't like what he said. Did you notice that in verse 41? They began to grumble. Didn't like it. And they say in verse 42, we know who you are. We know you come, where you come from. We know your parents. We know your hometown. How dare you say, I have come down from heaven. Nazareth's just a few miles up the road from here. We know who you are. Jesus tells them to stop grumbling. And goes on to say that no one can come to him unless the Father draws them. And he, Jesus, will raise them up on the last day, just as the prophets foretold. Everyone who really listens to God, says Jesus, will come to me. Only the Son has seen the Father. And he who believes in me has the gift of eternal life. He reminds them, their forefathers, they ate the manna in the wilderness, but they died. But he says, I'm the living bread. Feed on me and you will live forever. And then that controversial little statement is made when he talks about his flesh being given for the life of the world. In verse 52, the Jews began to argue. They said, is this cannibalism? How can this man give us his flesh to eat? And then those remarkable words come, verse 53 to verse 58. Jesus says, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. How hard it must have been to have heard those words that side of the cross. that side of the Last Supper. How difficult it must have been to have taken that truth on board. As we were hearing Derek last night say, unless the Holy Spirit opens a man or a woman's eyes, they cannot see, let alone enter, the kingdom of God. There were some that believed in that crowd. For many, it was above their heads. But what Jesus was speaking of was not cannibalism, but he was speaking about intimate fellowship. Those who trust him as Savior and Lord, those who put him at the center of their lives, those who feed on him by faith in their hearts with thanksgiving, those who remember him in bread and in wine, who don't stray very far from the cross of Calvary and all that it means in terms of redemption, forgiveness, access to the Father, new life from heaven. Jesus said that sort of fellowship. Unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. If you look down in verse 60, some of his disciples found it too much to bear. On hearing it, John says, many of his disciples said, this is a hard teaching. Who can accept it? And Jesus, aware what they were saying and the grumbling that was going on, he said, does this offend you? Does it offend you? A faith that has a cross at the center? A faith that speaks about a body being broken and blood being poured out in order that you might be forgiven? He says, what if you see the Son of Man ascend to where he was before? The Spirit gives life, the flesh counts for nothing. The words I've spoken to you, says Jesus, they're spirit and they are life. Yet some of you do not believe. Do you see in verse 66 that sad phrase? From this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him. That was the line in the sand. They didn't want to go any further. They couldn't grasp a hold of it. They hadn't understood that revelation that comes alone from the Spirit of God that enabled them to see the kingdom of God and enter the kingdom of God. They turned their backs. This, they said, is one claim too many. And dear Simon Peter, when Jesus looks in verse 37 and says to the others, do you want to go too? What does Peter say? Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We believe and know that you are the Holy One of God. I find it intriguing. I've puzzled about this. Why Jesus would say to the 12, do you want to go as well? Then I realized he wanted them either to have real faith, but certainly not a fake faith. That was why Jesus was saying, do you want to go as well? You see, this chapter that we've swept through in these last minutes gives us this picture of Jesus, the bread of life, speaking about how men and women the world over in every age and every generation who want to come to know God's forgiveness, what it is to be born into the family of God, have to come to that place of surrender and commitment to Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who laid down his life on the cross in order that we might be forgiven. And such an intimacy of relationship that Jesus speaks of it as eating his flesh and drinking his blood. Speaking about the fact that there is no other way. Our goodness, our church going, our religious background, our parentage, wherever we were born, wherever we were educated, these things matter nothing. In fact, they are barriers. It is only through faith in Christ alone, what Jesus did by his death on the cross and by his powerful resurrection from the dead, that sinful people like you and I can know a holy God. That's what Jesus is saying. And for some, it was too much. It was too much. Friends, what do we draw from this tonight? I think we draw three very important facts of spiritual life. Fact number one, people have a spiritual hunger. famous psychologist said in that well-known saying that human beings have a God-shaped blank within them that only God can fill. We have a spiritual dimension to ourselves. When Desmond Morris came to write his famous book, The Naked Ape, he was making a statement that many, many people would hold to be true, that human beings are nothing more than sophisticated monkeys, monkeys without fur. And that has been pumped through the educational system in our country for years. We've told people, young people, you're nothing more than a monkey without fur. But the Bible says that human beings are more than bodies and brains, but there is a spiritual dimension to humankind. Jesus put it this way, Matthew chapter 14, verse 26. What good will it be, said Jesus, for a man if he gains the whole world, yet forfeits his soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul? And what Jesus is saying there is this: your soul is the most valuable thing that you possess. That's the part of you that lives forever. Your body will wear out, your mind will stop working, but your soul is the part of you that lives forever. So if a man or a woman gains everything in the world and lives to a great age and yet loses their soul, they have lost the most important thing that they possess. And when we read these words that Jesus said, I am the bread of life, what he is underscoring here is that human beings are more than bodies and more than brains, but we have a spiritual dimension. And that spiritual dimension can be only satisfied when we come to a personal, living relationship with God through Jesus. Spiritual fact of life number two. People feed themselves on the wrong things. We live in a secular society. We find it very easy to look outside and see people. Oh yeah, they try, maybe people you work with or live with, they try and fill that God-shaped blank with all sorts of things, possessions, hobbies, relationships, and it doesn't fit. We're very good at critiquing the world around us. We know that we live in a materialistic society. Some of you were alive when Harold Macmillan spoke those famous words, we've never had it so good. And he was right. One of the Sunday newspapers this weekend carried a main feature article. Why is it, they say, in Britain today we have more than at any other time in our history and yet we are dissatisfied? That's a secular newspaper. Why? We have everything to live with, but nothing to live for. We live in a society where people know how to make a living, but don't understand how to make a life. One of the leading secular futurologists, those who look and assess trends in the world, not a Christian, wrote some years ago about everything that we've got in our world with information and technology at our fingertips. And he said this: we are drowning in information, but starved of true knowledge. But friends, the people who come up in a bad life light in John chapter 6 are not secular people, but religious people. You see, you can be a religious person and feed on the wrong things. If you look at that chapter, you'll see that some were pursuing Jesus for what they could get out of him. That's why he challenges them in the way he does. He'd fed them the day before, and they wanted him to feed them today and tomorrow. It's a great example of what I call fire alarm faith. You know when you're in a building, there's a little glass that says, in case of emergency, break glass. And there are some who have a fire alarm faith. I've got a doctor's appointment or an important interview at work or an examination or life's a bit difficult, I can't pay the mortgage. Then at those moments, we smash the glass. God is there for our convenience. The advert I saw in a catalogue for a a little 4-inch plastic glow-in-the-dark Jesus. You could put this little model by your bed and it glowed at night. Seeking him for what we can get out of him. He challenged them about looking to people rather than God. You see how he corrects them in the middle of verse 32 of chapter 6? He says it was God who provided, not Moses. And religious people can often put others in the place of God. It may be your minister, your pastor, a speaker, a worship leader, a Christian who leads your house group, somebody who's been influential. We can substitute people in the place of God. And instead of having a faith in him, one of the dangerous signs is when we're not prepared to go to God and seek him first, but we want to go to this person and get their advice. And then you notice too, Jesus criticizes them because they were so locked into the past, they couldn't see what God was doing in the present. Their minds were fixed 1,500 years before, a manna in the wilderness. And Jesus is saying, look what God's doing today. The bread of heaven. And one of the tendencies of religious people who feed themselves in the wrong things is that we can feed ourselves on traditionalism. Don't get me wrong, I thank God for tradition, but traditionalism is idolatry. We can worship the past or people of the past or methods of the past. All of those things are feeding on the wrong sort of substance. Spiritual fact of life, number three. Number one, people have a spiritual hunger. Number two, people feed themselves on the wrong things. Fact number three, only Jesus can satisfy our spiritual hunger. I am the bread of life, says Jesus. I am the bread of life. And the depth of intimacy that Jesus uses in his language, as John records it here, eating his flesh, drinking his blood, he's looking to the cross. That's at the heart of our faith. The empty cross of Jesus. Do understand that, won't you? That's so important. The empty cross of Jesus. He died once for all. He rose again from the dead. The gateway into heaven is open. But the empty cross of Jesus stands at the very heart of all that we're called to believe. It's the entry point. It's the place of beginning. It's a place from which we dare not stray very far. It's the place where we find forgiveness, renewal. It's the place where we find a fresh perspective on ourselves and our circumstances. It's the place we need to come when relationships are broken. The empty cross of Jesus. You see, the bread of life is able, he is able to satisfy those deepest longings. Whatever that longing might be in your life, whatever that restless search might be, maybe the person nearest and dearest to you doesn't even know what that is, but you know what it is. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, says, I'm the bread of life. I can feed in a way that no one else can. So here's the question tonight. What am I feeding on? I wonder if in the tent tonight I'm speaking to someone who's never given their life to Jesus. I want to say to you tonight, do it now. Do it now. Open your life to him. Confess the fact that you're a sinner. You don't deserve God's love and forgiveness. You deserve his punishment. But in his mercy, he calls you to himself. Sitting in your seat now, say, Lord Jesus, I give my life to you. Start to feed on the bread that satisfies. Turn away from those things you've been filling your life up with. You will never be happy. Remember a friend of mine who's a pastor in Greece telling me, Aristotle Onassis, at that stage, one of the richest men in the world, married to Jackie Onassis, arguably one of the most beautiful women in the world. A few months before he died, interviewed on Greek television, the interviewer said to him, Mr. Onassis, do you have any unfulfilled ambitions? He said, only one, to find true peace of mind. What shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world, yet loses his soul? Turn to Christ tonight. I believe I'm speaking to some of us as followers of Jesus, and as you come to Keswick, you've heard God speak to you in the Bible readings. This morning, as we thought about holiness and what it means to be conformed to the image of God's Son, God's been speaking to you because you know you've been feeding on the wrong things. And you're not where you should be. You are not where you once were. And Jesus says to you tonight, empty your hands, drop what you've got, and come and feed on me, the bread of life. I've got a question I've been living with over the last few weeks. Simply this. I long for people in our nation to come to know Jesus. We talk often about the unchurched. Sometimes we talk about the de-churched. Friends, I have a passion for those who are non-churched, who don't even know who Jesus is. Like the head teacher who had a mother on the phone, true story, had a mother on the phone because her boy had come home and said that there had been a man in assembly this morning swearing. Mother rang the head teacher and said, I'm really worried about this. Head teacher arranged to see her. When they got to the bottom of it, do you know what it was? They'd had a local minister who'd come in and had told the Christmas story about Jesus. And the only context in which that child had heard the name of Jesus was as a swear word. But friends, we believe that Jesus is the bread of life. How come so many of his followers look malnourished? Because if we are feeding on him, if we are living in him and him in us, then a hungry world around us is going to take notice. You agree with that? A hungry world around us is going to take notice. I never met Harry, but I know his story. Harry was an old man who lived in a town, went to one church, but when he went shopping every day, passed another church, a church that was open during the week. And he used to slip in at the back on his way back from the shops and sit in the back pew for about half an hour every day. And one of the ministers in the church, having done this for several months, stopped him and said, can you tell me a little bit about yourself? Introduced himself. And Harry explained that he was a Christian. He went to another church in the town. But he said each day, he said, I'd just like to pop in here. And I put my shopping down and I sit down. He said, I have a little ritual. He said, I just come in and say, Jesus, it's Harry. And he said, I just sit quietly for about half an hour. And he said, I feel the Lord just speaks to me, reminds me about things out of the Bible, causes me to pray. But he said, it's just a little point in the middle of my day that I look forward to. Months went by, and one day the minister noticed that Harry hadn't been in for about a week. Made inquiries, found out where he lived, discovered he was a widower, and that he had a fall and had gone into the town hospital. So he managed to track him down and got to the ward reception desk, and there was a nurse there. And he said, I'm afraid I don't know much about this guy. I know he's Harry, she said. Oh, yeah, Harry. And as they were walking along the corridor, she said, you know, Harry is the brightest patient we've got. She said, we've got some real pains in here, but Harry is a delight. So I was talking to him the day before yesterday. I said, Harry, how come you're always so cheerful? And he said, it's on account of my visitor. And she said, but you don't have any visitors. He said, oh, yes, I do. Every day, midday on the dot, stands at the foot of my bed and says, Harry, it's Jesus. Friends, that's a life of faith. Harry probably couldn't preach a sermon to save his life. But his life is a sermon. Let's pray. Jesus, my shepherd, saviour, friend, my prophet, priest, and king. My Lord, my life, my way, my end. Accept the praise I bring. Weak is the effort of my heart, and cold my warmest thought. But when I see thee as thou art, I'll praise thee as I ought. Till then, I would thy love proclaim with every fleeting breath. And may the music of thy name refresh my soul in death. Lord Jesus, bread of life, we worship you and offer our lives. Amen.
We'll bring our time together to an end with the song that we learnt at the beginning, a song which resolves to feast at the fountain of delight, our beautiful Saviour, Jesus himself. So let's rise and sing, "All My Days, I Will Sing This Song of Gladness." All my days.
All my days I will sing this song of gladness, give my praise to the fountain of delight. For in my helplessness you heard my cry, and waves of mercy poured down on my life.
I will trust. Do please sit down. And as we sit, let's bow our heads as we pray for David and we pray for ourselves. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have revealed your word to us. We thank you that you've inspired the writers of that word. And we pray that this evening you will illuminate our hearts and minds. We pray that you will find in those hearts receptive soil, ready to respond in obedience, to hear and obey. And we commit to you our brother David. We thank you so much for the ministry that he has brought to many of us over many years. And we ask that you will use him this night to bring your word to us. Fill him with your Holy Spirit, we pray, and give us ears to hear and hearts to obey. In Jesus' name, amen.
Two weeks ago, I was in Cuba, in Havana, and I was attending their international council meetings for our World Alliance of Baptists, the family of Baptists worldwide. And one evening, 2 weeks ago, 40 of us, as pastors, were invited to go out to the towns and the villages around Havana to take meetings. And I was told that I had to be ready for 7 o'clock, and the pastor would be there to collect me. Well, he arrived in a 1951 Buick car. If you've seen any pictures of Havana, it's mainly sort of Chryslers, Dodgers, and Buicks from the 1950s that are around on the streets. And what I didn't realize was that, in fact, it's propelled by gas petrol, which is down by the passenger seat in a plastic bottle. And so there's no smoking on the way to church, I can assure you. And so off we went in this 1951 Buick, 7 of us. And on the way it stopped, but they jumped out and they did something and it got going again. And no shock absorbers, so every sort of hole we came to, we sort of gently lowered the car in and then out the other side. So on the way there, through the interpreter, I said, when we have cars as old as this in my country, we give them a name because they remind us of our grandma. It's as old as that. So I said, I christened this car Emily. And they thought that was very funny, more funny than you did just now. And we preached and we had a wonderful time. And as we left this village chapel, they gave me 3 mangoes and they gave me a clay model of a Buick car. And they said, we want you to take Emily home with you, which I did. The greatest fruit of the evening was that some Cubans became Christians and trusted Christ as Savior. Whilst I was there, I met up with a Hungarian friend of mine, a young man called Sandor, who's in his early 30s, and he has a wonderful story to tell. One day, I hope he'll come to Keswick and tell his own story. He was brought up in a communist home. His grandmother was the secretary of the local communist party. And he was rocked to sleep each night, not with Bible stories, but with communist party songs. At the age of 14, he couldn't stand home and he ran away and he lived in a railway carriage. He lived in one of these railway trucks in a sidings and he fell into bad company. There were drug addicts there. He survived that episode of his life. He did national service. And during national service, he was making one day an illegal phone call on a high security line. And it was intercepted. And the soldier on the other end told him off, but the soldier on the other end of the line was a Christian. And having told him off, he then began to tell him the good news about Jesus. And he became a Christian. And he was called into God's family, and he was called into the ministry. And then God used his skills as a soldier and his great courage to be a wonderful Christian, not only as a pastor, but also aiding relief and development work. He's been into places like Grozny and Chechnya, where 2 of our Baptist pastors were beheaded. He's gone into Serbia. But I think the real faith story of Sandor's life is that God, he felt, was speaking to him to go and knock on the door of the North Korean embassy in Budapest. And he went and asked to see the ambassador. In amazement, he got in to see the ambassador. And he said to the ambassador, I have a vision for taking food and medicine to your beleaguered country of North Korea. He said, I believe that God wants me to collect $1 million worth of food and medicine. So the ambassador said, have you got the food and medicine? And Sandor said, no, I haven't. He said, have you got $1 million? He said, no, I haven't. But he said, within a month, I believe I could. And he said, I believe that God, if we prayed, will give us the food and medicine we need. He said, could I pray now in the North Korean embassy? So he prayed in front of the ambassador, Lord, give us the food and medicine that we need to take into North Korea. And within a month, with the aid of North American and British aid agencies, he had collected and got the transport for $1 million worth of food and medicine, and eventually it arrived in North Korea. Why do I tell you this story? Because it is a good example of a man who heard what God said and obeyed what God said. He was a doer of the word from the moment he became a Christian through that telephone call, to the moment when God has said all sorts of things to him about risk your life for the gospel, for the sake of needy people. Now tonight, it's about doing the word. And I want you to turn to Luke chapter 8. I've slightly revised the passages that were given. As you know, there were many verses in this chapter, this section of witness to the truth. So we're only going to look at the first 21 verses of Luke 8. And I'm giving it a subtitle of, Are You Listening? Are you listening, really listening? That's how Eugene Peterson looks at verse 18 of chapter 8. Therefore, consider carefully how you listen. That's the key verse in this section. It's supported by verse 8, where Jesus says, He who has ears to hear, let him listen. And Jesus' words in verse 21, My family are those who hear God's word and put it into practice. Are you listening? Really listening? It's the key thing for this evening. Now, it was interesting to hear about the history of Keswick on this 125th birthday, and I'm sure that with me you listened with interest to what Charles had to say last night in the interview. I believe, though, that the history of Keswick, and I've been coming here for many, many, many years, not as far back as D.L. Moody and Watchman Nee. But I have to say that the history of Keswick for me is not only about great preachers. It's about great listeners. And there wouldn't be the mark of God upon this convention if there hadn't been great doers of the word. That's why it isn't just the preacher that is on trial tonight. We're all on trial. And every time somebody stands here to expound God's word, it's not how did he or she do, it's how did we do as we leave the tent. You see, there will be a result this evening. Let me tell you, according to the parable that Jesus spoke, there is always a result when the word is preached. There is either fruit, or there is fruit in the making that never actually makes it as fruit, or there is no fruit. That's what the parable's talking about. That's your life as the seed of God's word has fallen into your heart this day. And that's why we have to say to one another, are you listening? Really listening? God has been preparing your heart for this World Mission Evening. You may be like Kathy, and it may be over 6 years. It may be Jackie over 30 years. It may be just this particular week. And he's going to invite some of you at the end of this evening to publicly stand and make a commitment to say, I am going to serve Jesus Christ. I believe in some of your hearts, God wants to resurrect a word. A word of challenge about service, which has been choked. It's been choked by the devil, by pressures, by anxieties, by cares about things that don't really matter. You know the call of God is to seek first his kingdom, and you have sought everything but his kingdom. And God in his grace is coming back tonight to say, I'm asking you to present your life as an offering for fruitful service. So are you listening? Really listening? The setting is Luke chapter 8, as you know, and in verse 1, Jesus is traveling between towns and villages on a preaching mission, preaching the good news of the kingdom of God. Good news to the poor, freedom for prisoners, sight to the blind, and the release of the oppressed. And at the end of chapter 8, one of my favorite stories in the Gospel of Luke, the release of the man who lived in the town cemetery, and they were so frightened of him, they bound him with chains, and Jesus came in and released the oppression. And the fruitful preaching that accompanied Jesus' ministry, we heard it last night in chapter 7, the centurion's servant was healed, the widow of Nain received her son back from the dead, and here you have the sinful woman also in chapter 7. That's the sign of the fruitful preaching of Jesus. In verse 2, you see that Jesus isn't alone on this preaching mission. There are 12 disciples with him, and there are some women who have been cured of evil spirits and diseases. They're named Mary Magdalene, who was not so much a sinful woman. 7 demons is probably a sign that she was a woman with a very great mental disorder. And Jesus was deeply compassionate to her, as we need to be with people with such illness. And she was so grateful that she bound herself to the company of Jesus. There was Joanna, whose husband was the chief executive of Herod's household. And there was Susanna, we're not too told too much about her. And the phrase then says, and many others. And these women, apparently, they helped to support Jesus and the 12 out of their own means. It's a glimpse into how the preaching missions of Jesus around the towns and villages of Galilee were supported. It's the basic principle which comes down right down to today. People whose lives have been changed by Jesus demonstrate their gratitude by supporting the ministry of Jesus. Are you listening? Really listening? I want you to know there are 2 offerings tonight. There's going to be an offering of people, and there's going to be an offering of money, and some of you out of great prosperity are able to demonstrate whether you are deeply grateful for what God has done in your life through Jesus Christ. In the same city of Havana, met a pastor who I've known for a few years, and he told me a story about a church that suffered a dreadful storm, and their roof was damaged, and it was going to cost $10,000 to prepare and repair the roof. So the pastor comes to the congregation the next Sunday, and he says, I've got good news and I've got bad news. He says, the bad news is that there's been a storm, and our roof is damaged, and it's going to cost $10,000 to fix it. The good news is that God knew there was going to be a storm. And he knew that our roof was going to be damaged. And he knew that it was going to cost $10,000. And in fact, he's given us $10,000, and all we need to do is collect it in. Not so much a collection as a collect it in. That's what we have to do for the mission of Jesus Christ. Out of grateful hearts, we simply release the money we already possess. I don't believe in raising money. Never done that in church life. You simply release. The money we need is the money we already possess. The money that God needs from this congregation of his people this evening to do the mission work that we want to support is already here. That's why in the offering, the second offering, some of you are going to be deeply touched in the place where it can hurt most. But that's going to be a sign of how deeply grateful you are to Jesus. And then, of course, you have what Luke says in verse 4 about crowds. A very large crowd. You know, why is Luke so particular about this? Look at it. While a large crowd was gathering, that's large enough, and people were coming to Jesus from town after town. It's a huge number of people that are gathering. Why? Because they are potential listeners to the parable of Jesus, in fact, all his teaching, the preaching and proclaiming of the kingdom of God. And in the minds, especially of the disciples, and particularly of 21st century disciples, which we are, we have to ask, why is it, when there is clear proclamation of the good news of Jesus, that there isn't a fruitful response every time? Why is it some respond and believe and are saved? And why is it that others just ask questions and ponder and say, well, can I think about Jesus, that Jesus, and walk away? And why is it that some are deeply offended and turn their back and no longer want to be disciples of Jesus? It's a big question. That's why Luke paints this picture of many, many people coming, hundreds of them, because it's a preparation for the parable which begins in verse 5, the parable of preaching and listening. So the crowds are gathered, the preacher is ready, and the story begins. So are you listening? Really listening? Here's the everyday story of country folk. It's very familiar to the hearers because they include, among these hundreds, no doubt, farm workers and landowners. The story has a beginning, it has a middle, and it has an end. In the beginning, the farmer sows the seed. In the middle, the seed faces the usual hazards of farming. Poor soil, little moisture, birds of prey, thorns and brambles which come in to choke whatever plant has arisen out of the seed. And at the end, there is some seed that has overcome the hazards, and it comes through the seasons, and there is a large harvest. And what is stored in the barns apparently is in no comparison to the little seed which was at the beginning of the story. So it's brief, it's familiar, it's commonplace. You sow the seed, you face the hazards, you wait through the seasons, and you reap the results. And at the end, the storyteller, with a change of voice, says Luke, lifts up his voice and says, "He who has ears to hear, let him listen." So they've come for many miles, walked, no doubt, and the story lasts less than 30 seconds. I would imagine if they'd ordered the tape, they would be asking for their money back. And in verse 9, is it any wonder that the disciples asked the question, Jesus, what was all that about? You told them what they already knew. It's so familiar, it's a nice story, but what does it mean? Are you listening? Really listening? The first sign of genuine listening to God on a world mission evening, or any time we open God's word, is that you ask an important question. Why is that so vital? Verse 10, it's the only way to understand God's secrets. You see, the parables of the kingdom are told in such a way that people can see without seeing and hear without understanding. Or to quote Brother John this morning, they can become invisible to the eye, inaudible to the ear, inconceivable to the mind. And yet, Jesus wants the secrets of his kingdom to be known. Look at verse 17. Nothing hidden that will not be disclosed. And in verse 18, whoever has will be given more. You will be open to more understanding about the secrets of the kingdom the more you ask the question, such as the disciples asked, what does this mean? You see, the secret has to be revealed. We heard all that this morning. In this morning, it was about the illuminating work of the Holy Spirit. But until the Holy Spirit is given, Jesus is the teacher. He is the one who has to illuminate the minds of the disciples. And what they're doing here is expressing an utter dependence upon Jesus. It's a sign of meekness, not a sign of impatience or just curiosity. They will look back and realize that this was their humble moment when they were saying, Lord, please teach us the meaning of this pretty commonplace story that you've just told. It's the ministry of the Holy Spirit to take questions and to lead people deeper into the secrets of the kingdom. He's going to take your questions this evening about the part that you're going to play in God's world mission, and he's going to be patient with those questions. He's not going to ignore them. In fact, they are part of the entrance porch into the secret of how you have been called and what part you're going to play, and how on earth can someone like you be God's messenger? Do you realize this is the way of God with people? Mary. The angel comes to Mary and tells her about the gift of the child that she's going to have. And what happens? When the teaching comes, it's followed by the question, how shall this be since I am a virgin? And in the answer, God leads her deeper into the secrets of the kingdom. The Holy Spirit will come upon you and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. You find it in that John 3 Nicodemus question that we had a reminder of this morning. How can a man be born again? The question. Does he have to climb back out into his mother's womb again? How can he do that as a grown man? And what does Jesus say? It's only flesh that gives birth to flesh, and it's spirit that gives birth to spirit. Or, in the new Stott in Keswick version, don't be a biblical literalist. You know, that's for those who were here this morning, you'll understand that. So in answer to the question, God gave further understanding into the mystery. What about the Ethiopian eunuch? Classic example from Acts chapter 8. Man gets hold of Isaiah, the book of Isaiah. He's reading it, and he comes to a point where he says, I can't understand this. So God brings him into touch with a man called Philip, and the question comes. Who's he talking about, himself or someone else? And so Philip, used by God's Spirit, began at that very passage and tells him the good news about Jesus. I want you to understand that questions have to be out on the table. Because if we're talking about the secret of the kingdom and how God's kingdom grows and how you're going to be a part in that, Jesus is ready for the questions this evening. And if you have to say, like Mary, how can this be? He's going to reassure you. And your response can be like Mary. I am the Lord's servant. Be it to me according to your word. That's all you have to say. There have been many important moments in my life. If I look back, I suppose one of the most important was when I took my first piano exam. I was probably about 6 or 7 years of age, and in the course of the exam, I fell off the piano stool. And somehow the piano examiner had to include this in her report. So very kindly, I've got the piece of paper to this day. She put on the report, this piece had vitality. In spite of one slight stumble. Very kind. I move forward a few years to this street behind me here, Eskin Street. To a room at the top of the stairs. It was a Wednesday. I felt that I'd got spiritual indigestion. I'd been to everything, and so had my friends, and I decided one morning to opt out, stayed in my room, and I distinctly remember God speaking to me from the servant song, Isaiah 42, verse 6, I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness. It was a very private moment for me. And at the Friday missionary meeting, the equivalent of this meeting, I stood and I committed my life to the Lord. I didn't know what that meant, but I knew that I was willing to say, Lord, any time, any place, any cost, I'm your man. I have to tell you, along the way, there were many questions. And there was a major setback, which would take me half an hour, so come and see me and I'll tell you about it sometime. I had to face some excuses. Had to face some opposition along the way, and that's why as part of Isaiah 42 it says, I will take you and hold you by the hand. Because you have to persevere in guarding the seed that God plants into your life. Sometimes excuses are really pitiful. You know, they have that echo in Scripture, Moses and Joshua. Sometimes God just reaches you through something which is rather silly, and I hope this isn't too silly for you to understand the meaning of it, especially in the missionary context. If you think you are too small and insignificant to be effective, you have never been in bed with a mosquito. Missionaries will know what that is all about. So after the question comes the interpretation, and that begins in verse 11. Jesus is now going to admit them to the secret of the parable. Verse 11, the seed is the word of God. As Jesus has been preaching from town to town, he hasn't just been telling good stories about farmers and about prodigal sons and about women who lose things around the house, and when they find it, they have a party. And he has been sowing the seed of the word through these stories. And this word is living and active and powerful. And when it drops into a life, then it accomplishes something. Chapter 7, we heard that so powerfully last night. God's seed of grace fell into the life of this sinful woman. And she had the faith to believe that she could come and seek the forgiveness of Jesus, and that's why he can say to her, your sins are forgiven, your faith has saved you, go in peace. That's God's living, powerful, effective word. And here this evening, I want you to know that people have been praying, not simply today, but according to the invitation of Jesus, you must pray to the Lord of the harvest to send people, workers, into the harvest field. If you believe God wants to do his mission in the world, then he has workers to perform that mission. Pray them into the mission field. So we have been obedient. We've responded to that. And we dare to believe this evening that God has spoken to some of you because the seed has fallen into your life. God has begun to sow the seed in your life. So when he says, who will go and who will I send? He's waiting for your response. So understand that this is not just the regional mission marketers who come and say, we want, as it were, more representatives, more salespeople out on the field in order that we might build our empire as a mission organization. This evening and every day this week, it is nothing other than the seed of the Word of God falling, falling, falling into lives. Of course, when it falls into lives, then there is the hazard of listening. How you listen, are you listening, really listening? Which is how then Jesus comes to the next part of the interpretation in verse 12. There are hazards to listening. I've traveled in many parts of the world and there are some hazards to worship before you get to listening. I remember going to Kathmandu where you leave your shoes at the door. You then come in and you're divided into men and boys on the left and women and girls on the right, and you sit on a hard floor. You go through the service and when you come out, you pick up your shoes, but before you pick up your shoes, you shake them out in case any cockroaches have gone in. And if you don't bother to shake your shoes out, then you crush those cockroaches with your toes as you put your shoes on. I've been to Kazakhstan, just a few miles where Alexander Solzhenitsyn spent his final years before he was sent into exile. And in Kazakhstan, they kneel on wooden floors for prayer. For what seemed to me about every 15 minutes, for about 15 minutes. That's a hazard to listening. In Africa, they have a wonderful way in their long services, which go from 10 o'clock till 4 o'clock in the afternoon. They have wandering up and down the aisle, not just lovely stewards with yellow jackets on, they have people with long poles, and they are wake-up poles. And they walk down the aisles, and woe betide if anybody's asleep, because they wake them up. I think that's a wonderful innovation at Keswick, Jonathan. We must bring that in sometime. Well, here's the first hazard to listening in verse 12. The first hazard to listening is hearing the word. And then the devil comes and snatches the word away. And look how serious that is. In the context of all the ministry of Jesus, it's serious because it means that people can't believe and they're never saved. Now, I assume that you were able to listen long enough to hear the good news of salvation, and you have heard and you are saved. But imagine, in this process of going on being saved, in the process of discovering what God wants for your life, there comes a moment, perhaps this moment in July 2000, when as the seed of the word falls this evening, that the harvest is great, the workers are few, and the question goes out, who will go? Who can I send? And before you can even settle into an understanding of that, the enemy has come and snatched the word away. Maybe through spiritual blindness or indifference, or perhaps through noises and distractions and temperature controls and the voice of the preacher and the version of the Bible, and we're easily offended by a phrase or the language that's being used. Friends, the Lord will not forgive you for all those things. Yes, His grace will cover it, but what I'm saying is the devil in this moment can be snatching away the valuable seed that wants to be sown in your heart with a concern for what part do I play in world mission. I had a wonderful example of how you can defeat the activity of the enemy who wants to come and snatch away the seed. There was a sermon taking place on Mary and Joseph. Two women sitting alongside one another, both listening intently. And then suddenly, outside, there came the noise of a chainsaw. It wasn't just going on for a couple of minutes. It went on for the whole period and extent of the sermon. And afterwards, one sister turned to the other and said, "That completely spoilt the sermon for me." And the other one said, "Well, that's amazing. Because God said to me, imagine as you listen to that story of Mary and Joseph, that's Joseph working in the carpenter's shop." A hazard of listening to the word. Look at the second hazard in verse 13. It's the hazard of hearing the word of God, receiving it with joy, but then testing and trouble comes. And because there's no root, in other words, there's no soil of faith. Because as you've heard from both Kathy and Jackie, and I'm sure to not say the same extent in Matthew's life, but you'll admit that the sale of a house when you've offered yourself to the Lord's service, and a life-threatening accident, such as Jackie had, and I'm sure that Matthew had his doubts and questions as well, these are testings. So when you stand this evening and say, "Lord, I'm your woman, I'm your man," don't imagine that on this night when you receive the word with joy, that there won't come testings and trouble. And you have to guard yourself for that moment. Have to make sure that there is moisture, there is soil, that it isn't just a rocky soil that you hear, receive the word at Keswick. And then by the time you've got home and you've shared it with somebody and they dismiss it so easily, the time and the testing is going to be an important time. And you have to persevere through that. It's a hazard. Doesn't mean to say the little seed won't survive, but be prepared for it. I sense that some of you have had some very real setbacks and sadnesses in these recent months. I keep my ear, as others do, to the ground here in Keswick, and I sense that some of you are disillusioned in Christian service. It's a time of real testing. You've come back home from somewhere, or you've come from the UK to here, and there is a danger, a real danger, that you are not going to go back and pick up what God gave you to do. Am I right? And God wants to come to you this evening and say, "I've brought you to this place in order that you might have a new beginning." Guard the seed against the hazard of testing and trouble. God wants to use his family to encourage you, to restore you, to cheer you. You know there is another Olympic Games, the alternative Olympic Games. It's for those with disabilities. It normally takes place sometime after the official Olympics. And on one occasion, there was this alternative Olympic Games, and there was the 100 meters race, and 9 runners, and they set off with their disabilities to make for the tape. And somewhere along the way, one of the runners fell. And he tried to get up, and he fell over again. And he tried, and he fell. And the second time that he fell, he lay on the track, and he sobbed. And the other 8 runners heard the sobbing, and one by one they stopped. And they came back to the place where their fellow runner had fallen. And they picked him up, and they held hands, and they walked together to the tape, and they crossed the line together, and there was a 15-minute standing ovation by the crowd. God says to some of you here this evening, such have been the testing and the trouble of that seed, the seed of my call, which you received with such joy. It fell into your life, and you're in danger, the hazard of allowing it just to fall on a rocky heart. And God says, bring in the soil of faith, add the moisture, let the family of God gather around, even tonight. Let's pick you up and let's run that race together, because there are a lot of together verses in the New Testament. You are not alone. The Holy Trinity is on your side, and so are the people of God. And the third hazard in verse 14 is about hearing the word. And then it becomes choked with worries and riches and pleasures. Let me ask you this. How many times have you been to a world mission evening before the Lord? How many times? Not just in Keswick, anywhere. How many times has the seed fallen into your life, God's word, his seed, calling you to offer life and talent and time and massive gifts? And every time you come, and perhaps you think about it, but you just say, before the Lord even, with a piety, Lord, this would be so disruptive. At this moment, family and work and church. Let me stop on church and let me tell you, it's God's church, and you can leave God's church to him. I've known people speak to me and say to me, David, if I left the church at this moment, it would fall down. They depend upon my giving, we as a family, etc., etc. And gently want, the Lord wants to say to you, Luke chapter 5 and verse 11 and Luke chapter 5 and verse 28, when Jesus said to Peter, follow me, he left everything and followed him. When Jesus said to Matthew, come and follow me, he left everything and followed him. Now don't get caught up with all the shorthand of what did that mean? Did they have to sell the house? Kathy would tell you, yes. But on this evening, when you're doing serious business with God, as the seed of his word falls into your life, you say to the Lord, Lord, this hazard of your word being choked with worries and riches and cares, some of them good and honorable, to do with investments and to do with finance and housing and children and health factors. Those are your questions. They must never be your excuses. Guard the seed. A few months ago, I was in a Cambridgeshire village, and in the front row, a man with a London Welsh rugby shirt on. Never happened before or since. And I met them afterwards, Alan and Megan. On the 26th of July, next Wednesday, my wife's birthday, that's the way I'm remembering it. On the 26th of July, they and their 3 children fly to Kathmandu. I met the children afterwards, teenagers. I told them if it's still open, they must visit Mike's Breakfast in Kathmandu. Great place. And if they go to Pokhara, look out for Fishtail Mountain. And I was chatting to these youngsters, and they said to me, you've talked an awful lot about Mum and Dad. You won't forget we had to say yes as well. And God says to you this evening, trust me with your family. Trust me with your church. Trust me with your work. Trust me with your health. Trust me with everything. And there's the fourth hazard in verse 15. You wouldn't think there was a hazard here, would you? But it's there. These are the ones who hear the word. These are the noble and of good heart. They hear the word, they retain it, and then there's that word, they persevere. You see, there's still a hazard so near to the harvest, in such a good soil. It's the issue of perseverance, and it's the perseverers who produce the good crop. And the real listeners are those who have this bumper harvest. It becomes obvious. In fact, the language changes in verse 16, and a bumper harvest becomes a shining light. But Jesus says in verse 16, you don't light a lamp and hide it under a jar. If I've done a work in your life, then you let your little light shine. You let people know by your good works that I have called you. The fruit becomes obvious, in other words. Yes, you have to persevere through the hazards of the devil trying to snatch the seed away and the pressures of testing and trouble and those things that just choke the life out of the seed. Bill and Lucy, missionaries I stayed with a little while ago, 18 months ago, Lucy had a mastectomy. They had every reason to give up. But they persevered. 4 children, 8 grandchildren, who they rarely see. They've just had a few months on furlough, and they said, it breaks our hearts to be separated. But this is what they said. But this is where God wants us to be. And I met some of their fruit, real live converts in a church planting situation. They would agree with what Steve said on Sunday, it's too early to quit. And they might even agree, because they're not far off Kathy's age, about we're going to quit when the Zimmer frame doesn't work anymore. And God comes this evening and says to you, have you been listening? Really listening? The seed of God's word concerning his mission in the world has been sown in our hearts in many and different ways. Lift up your eyes, look on the harvest. Who's going to go? Who can I send? We're coming to that moment of commitment in our service. God has called some of you to Christian ministry and Christian missionary service. All of us are called to full-time work for Jesus. All of us are called to serve him. But some of us are very specifically called to serve him in particular ways. And you're going to be given an opportunity in a moment to stand. It's going to be a sign of your allegiance to the Lord Jesus Christ. And publicly you're going to say, Lord Jesus Christ, any time, any place, at any cost. Some of you will stand as a confirmation of a private agreement that has been made with the Lord at some future, at some previous occasion. And when he called, you said yes, and you are now going public. Some of you are going to stand to make a recommitment, because the pressures and the testings have really crowded in, and anxieties maybe have choked the life. With joy, you made a commitment, but you haven't persevered, and God wants to come and say to you, because you haven't fallen, he wants to come and say to you this evening, don't lose heart. My calling and keeping power by God's mercy is able to keep you, to renew that call to go back to that difficult place here in the UK, in some other part of the world where you've been. Please persevere. God's going to speak to some of you like he spoke to Matthew, and he wants you to stand, because you're going to say, Lord, short-term service. Or Jackie, you're going to say, I'm going to be a tent maker. I'm going to go in and I will gossip the gospel, and I'll invite people into my home, and I'll put up with the pressures. Or maybe like Kathy, you're going to be someone who in those later years, you're going to say, I'm going to be a volunteer. It's high time Some of you volunteered. You thought that risk-taking was for young people, not for old people. And you lead such an ordered life, such a well-ordered life. And you're renowned for that. And here God is about to come in and mess your life up. You're going to stand and say, Lord, I give you permission to disrupt my life. And some of you, God's going to touch your pockets, because he's come to remind you this evening that when Jesus transforms a life, you demonstrate your gratitude by supporting Jesus and his mission in the world. It's a very solemn moment, and I believe that we need just to have a quiet moment of prayer before we do anything else. Let's pause. Remember to guard the seed of the word as God has spoken to you this evening. So let's open our eyes as I say this to you. If you sincerely believe God has called you to serve him any time, any place, any cost, will you stand now? Will you please stand? If God has called you to serve him anywhere, any time, any place, this is the moment to stand. Will you stand as a sign of recommitment? I'm going back to that place, Lord. I'm going to stand as a volunteer, as a short-termer. Stand as a sign that you're willing to say to the Lord, here am I, Lord. I'm willing to serve you. One more opportunity before I offer this prayer. Guarding the seed of the word, noting the hazards. Lord Jesus Christ, these who stand before you would say they are no longer their own, but yours. Therefore, will you take us as we are and put us to where you will? Send us wherever according to your purposes. Equip us by your Holy Spirit, and use us fruitfully, we pray, in the service of your kingdom. For Jesus' sake. Amen. Please sit. If you have stood, in a moment, Jonathan will explain to you how we're going to talk to you after this service. We're going to now have the offering before Jonathan comes and announces it. May I just say to you, to remind you of verse 4. People who gave out of their means to support the ministry of Jesus.
As David has said, as we sing in just a moment, we would like to take up the offering. May I just have a word to explain how we would like to conclude this evening, which we will do in just 2 or 3 minutes now. The offering will take place immediately as expression of our response to God's word. And we'll listen to the first verse of the hymn being played to us while that offering is taken. We'll remain seated for 2 verses. Then on the final 2 verses of the hymn, could I ask those of you who kindly stood this evening just to come to the left of the stage here. We're not going to hold you back. We know you may have other things to do, but just for a moment to speak to Rosemary and some others who will be wearing badges, just to explain how we can send something to you and help you in some way. So if you have taken that act to stand this evening, if you'd be kind enough, please, when I signal as we stand for the remaining verses, just to move forward. Then you'll be able to come over to the left of the stage and talk just for a moment while others leave. When we finish the hymn, could I say, please do leave quietly so that those conversations can take place. Those of you who are sitting to my right on the block here on the left, our brothers and sisters from Torch and others, we'd be very grateful if you were able to quietly move out and then others can sit in that section to the left of the stage while we talk briefly with those who've come. We won't be holding you for long, just for one moment to explain how we would like to help in the future. So we're going to sing together the great hymn, Facing a Task Unfinished, number 28. I think because we're already well underway with the offering, we will sing immediately verse 1, remaining seated. Stand to sing the remaining two verses. Some of you may well have wished you'd stood just a moment ago. Well, you're very welcome to come forward and talk to others here. So now those who've stood, as we all stand, please do come to the front, and that will allow you the opportunity to talk to others. Verse 3. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. The person who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, but doing it, he will be blessed in what he does. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship and empowering of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. We'd be very grateful if you could leave relatively quietly, please. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you, Rosemary. If you'd like to take a chair over on this side as soon as possible.